heavens declare the glory of God. And so should we. How about to God be the glory, great things he has done. Let's stand together as we sing. Because he has done great things for us, right?
And we are filled with joy.
To God be the glory.
receive Jesus, he gave the right to be called children of God. Mm-hmm. So you are a child of God when you trust in Jesus. Now, this one time at family camp, you know, this one time at family camp, you know what I'm going to say.
Oh, there's many times at family
camp.
There
are many times at family camp. It was one time at family camp. We were sitting outside this huge tent, this tabernacle, say, seats 500-600 people. And we were sitting out on the lawn, and we could see storm clouds coming from the west. And they got closer, and they got closer, and pretty soon we all that were sitting outside, we moved inside. And then pretty soon they started dropping the sides on the big tent, big circus tent, because it was going to... Yes. And we got to this song right when the thunder started booming, when we all get to heaven. And we were ready to go. We thought, we're all going to heaven right now, but that's okay. We're children of God, so that's fine.
And we try to sing louder than the thunder.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace in the mansions.
So excited about the children's message I messed up. Have a seat, everybody. Aubrey, would you like to come up for the kids' message? You can come up and stand right here next to me. I have something I want to show you. It's really kind of cool. Come on right up here. Come on. And you don't have to face everybody. You can just turn and look over here. So we got two flags up here, don't we? We got the American flag. See my little laser? That's what the cats chase, my laser, right? So that's the American flag over there, good old red, white, and blue, Old Glory as they call it. What do you think they call this flag? What's that one called? You know? Okay, that one's called the Christian flag. And so this is a test for all the children out there to see if you understand and see if you know what the Christian flag means. What are these colors signify and why is it like that? Well, first of all, let me tell you where it came from. There was a Sunday school teacher, kind of like Miss Elizabeth. And do you call her Aunt Jibs, too? Do you call her? No? You just pray, whatever. Libby? Okay. So, all that to say this. There was a Sunday school teacher, and a speaker didn't show up. And so he stood up to share and to speak, and he started thinking about the American flag. And he came up with this idea. You know, he said, we need a Christian flag. And so he came up with this idea of a Christian flag. This was 1897. by 1907, 10 years later, they had these flags. Now, there's nothing that tells you what church it is, right? It doesn't say what church it's from. It's basically a generic, general church Christian flag. Okay, let me come around this side. Yeah, this isn't going to work. There we go. I'm all tied up here, aren't I? So we have this big white section, and then we have the blue, and then we have the red. So the white section, what do you think that maybe represents? Anybody have an idea out in the big kids section? No. White as snow, that's what I thought, but that wasn't it. But it works if you want it to. It works that way. Actually, it does because white is the color of purity. It's the color of purity. And so most of the flag is all white. It's purity. It's also, you know, flag of surrender, because the white flag is a surrender, so it's kind of like that. And then blue is the color of fidelity. I didn't know that. Blue is color of fidelity, which is kind of like being faithful to the Lord, you know. And Jesus was faithful when he went to the cross. And what color is the cross? What color is a cross? It's red. And can you guess why it's red? I mean, it's might be kind of obvious. We have a red cross because of Jesus' blood. Jesus' blood is red, and he gave his life for us. And so the cross is more than just a symbol. Here, it is really telling us about the sacrifice of Jesus. So if you kind of go back the other way, you go start with the cross, you have the sacrifice of Christ, and then in him we become faithful, and the blue is kind of like water. Baptism, you could have baptism, could mean that one. And then white, he makes our sins white as snow, just like Nathaniel said. So how about that? So can I say a prayer with you real quick? Okay. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful young lady. Be with the other children who are off camping this weekend. But we're so grateful that Aubrey brought her parents here today. And so be with Aubrey, Lord. Thank you for your blessing her with a wonderful life. May she come to faith in Jesus, if she hasn't already, to trust in him. And bless her, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, sweetheart. She did a good job, didn't she? So I was talking to Nathaniel about this little lesson I wanted to do. And he said he knows the pledge to the Christian flag. Do you know the pledge to the Christian flag? There is one. I remember it, but not totally as good as he does. So he's going to share with us the pledge to the Christian flag.
If you would like to stand as you're able, we're going to do all the pledges. Is there a Bible up here? There it is. Okay. We will start with the American flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And the Christian pledge. No. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to its Savior, for whose kingdom it stands, the only Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again, with life and liberty for all who believe. And then there's a pledge to the Bible. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will guard its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Amen. Well, I've wanted to talk about discouragement. I've wanted to talk about depression, the hard times we're going through with pandemics and lies and false truths and just narratives that are being pushed and propagandas and God knows what else is going on. So when I get up here, it's easy just to stick to the notes. That way I don't get down a rabbit trail of negativity and then bring it back with a God's good and somehow that rallied it back in for you. It reminds me of the DC Talk song, What If I Stumble? What if I stumble? What if I fall? What if I lose my step and I make fools of us all? Will his love continue when my walk becomes a crawl? What if I stumble? I read an article headline the other day that said DC Talks Kevin Max is now considered himself an ex-evangelical. He says he's been progressing for decades. He suggests people need to question everything, including God's holy word, yet he promotes Marxist terrorist groups in order to be inclusive and accepting. It's the new norm. Deconstructing his faith, as we all should, he claims. But I don't believe that God's holy word is not true. I believe in that wholeheartedly. I believe in what it says in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. So don't discount its value just because you haven't discerned proper application, or because it convicts you to be holy as our Father in heaven is holy. I'm going to sing a song by Casting Crowns. It's called Slow Fade. It would always come on my Pandora station. It was just really inspiring to me, but at the same time, it touches on that nerve of close family and friends and people that I've grown up with telling me, I just don't believe in that stuff anymore, Nathaniel. I'm not there with you, which it breaks my heart, but it's not an instant thing. It's a slow fade, so that's what the song's about.
Second glance that ties your hands as darkness pulls the strings. Be careful, little feet, where you go, for it's the little feet behind you that are sure to follow. It's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade. Black and white are turned to gray and thoughts invade. Choices made, a price will be paid when you give yourself away. People never crumble in a day. It's a slow fade. It's a slow fade. Flattery leads to compromise, the end is always near. Be careful, little lips, what you say, for empty words and promises lead broken hearts astray. It's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade. Black and white are turned to gray and thoughts invade. Choices are made, a price will be paid when you give yourself away. People never crumble in a day. The journey from your mind into your hands is shorter than your thinking. Cause you just might be sinking. And it's a slow fade when you give yourself away. It's a slow fade. Black and white have turned to gray and thoughts invade. Choices are made, a price will be paid when you give yourself away. People never crumble in a day. Daddy's never crumbled in a day. Family's never crumbled in a day.
I feel God's pain in that song for his children that are wandering. The hopelessness that takes a hold. I'm reminded of the movie The Count of Monte Cristo. Edmond Dantès is imprisoned for 13 years on the Isle of Chateau d'If, and when he's first put into a cell, he notices on the wall it's inscribed, "God will grant me justice." And he picks up a stone even after he's been beat several times, and he keeps carving that deeper into the wall. And he just carves that for years after he's been beat, after he's been tortured, after he's been mistreated. God will grant me justice. But after years dwindle on and the pain endures, that rock slips from his hand. He just can't even pick it up, scrape it in anymore. It's just too much. I've felt that rock slip from my hands. Discouraged by the lack of others' faith or the sheer loss of it altogether, I know God will grant us justice, but it'll be in his time, not ours. Abraham was promised lineage and offspring as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the shore, and yet he had to make it to 100 years old before he finally had a son, Isaac. Just waiting, like, Lord, when's it gonna happen? It finally did, but he had to endure, he had to have faith, he didn't have to deconstruct anything, he had to trust in God, he didn't have to wander away, he had to keep his own focus and his eyes on God. There, his son Isaac had Jacob, who had 12 sons. And if you've ever heard the story of the coat of many colors, Jacob favored Joseph over all of his sons and had a beautiful coat made for him. And his brothers were jealous of him. And it didn't help that Joseph was having dreams that all of his family were bowing down to him, and then he'd go and tell him about it. It's not a good idea. So they didn't like him very much. He was already getting the favoritism, and then he was telling you, hey, guess what? In my dreams, you guys are bowing down to me. It's pretty weird. What do you think of that? They thought, well, we're going to do the most logical thing. We're going to sell you into slavery. And God allowed him to prosper there as he was sold into Egypt as a slave. And he was put into a house of an Egyptian master, and he was a slave there. But he prospered, and God was with him. But then after a while, the slave master's wife wrongfully accused him, and he was imprisoned. So now he was the favorite son, treated the best, sold into slavery, still treated pretty good, but now he's been wrongfully imprisoned. Now he's sitting in prison wondering, this can't be God's plan for my life. But he didn't lose his faith. He kept on believing. And then a while later, while he was in the prison, Pharaoh's cupbearer and the baker were also imprisoned, and they were having strange dreams, and they came to Joseph and told him about the dreams, and Joseph was able to interpret them, and he was accurate in his interpretations. The baker would be killed, and the cupbearer would be placed back into Pharaoh's employ. And Joseph told him before he was released, he said, hey, remember me. Speak to Pharaoh on my behalf. I've been wrongfully imprisoned here. I don't deserve to be here. I was taken from my homeland, and now I don't even deserve the crime that I'm being punished for in this prison, so remember me. The cupbearer goes back into the presence of Pharaoh, forgets all about him. So they think Joseph was probably in prison for like 10 years, just waiting around. So after the cupbearer was released, 2 years went by, so he was in there for about 8 years, another 2 years after the cupbearer was released, and then finally Pharaoh starts having odd dreams, and he calls in all the wise men and magicians of Egypt, and none of them can interpret the dream. And then just then the cupbearer, oh yeah, I was supposed to tell you about this guy who can interpret dreams. Forgot all about it. He's actually sitting in prison over there. You could go get him and he could do that for you. So Joseph is brought in. He's so grimy and matted, he has to have a bath and his beard trimmed off and his hair cut. 10 years in prison, that's just what it does to you. So Joseph comes in and he interprets the dreams for Pharaoh. And Pharaoh puts him into the second highest position in Egypt. But all those things had to happen to him first. That was the sovereignty of God that allowed him to be put into that position where his family would prosper, where his lineage would move on. They would survive the famine that would ravage the rest of the land. And the Israelites flourished in Egypt and multiplied greatly until a new Pharaoh arose and put a yoke of slavery on them for 400 years. And I'm sure in that time many a heart grew cold towards the circumstances, and they questioned, why did God allow this to happen? Why are we now enslaved? And then God lifted up Moses, first to be a member of the royal family, and then to shepherd a flock in the wilderness for 40 years, the same wilderness that he would wander around with the Israelites in. So he was prepared in all ways for what he was going to do. God prepared him for the necessary task to come, which would be freeing his people. God inflicted Pharaoh and his people with 10 plagues, the last of which was the firstborn of every household would die. The Israelites were spared by smearing their doorposts, tops and side, with the blood of a lamb of 1 year without blemish. Death would pass over them and they wouldn't be harmed. The significance of the blood can be found in Genesis, in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve sinned. God sacrificed an animal's innocent blood to cover their sin and used its hide to cover their shame, just as Christ's body was broken and his blood was shed to cover our sin and our shame. The whole Bible describes over and over in detail why Jesus had to give his life in the exact way that he did. Leviticus 17:11 says, "For the life of a creature is in its blood, and I have given it to you to make atonement for yourselves on the altar. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life." That the sin of the world would be placed on Jesus, just like the sacrificial lamb. They would place their hands on the lamb, and then they would slaughter it, and their sin would be in that animal's blood. And as the blood poured out, it would wash the sin away. And that's what Christ did on the cross. He was a sacrificial lamb without blemish or defect, and all the sin of the world was placed on him as his body was broken and his blood was shed for us. The price was paid in full. When you accept that he did that for you and me, and even those with the freedom to choose not to believe in him at all, welcome him into your life, allowing your body to become the temple of the Most High God. Hebrews 3:1 and 2a say, "Therefore, holy brothers and sisters, who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. He was faithful to the one who appointed him, who is our Father in heaven." 6b continues, "And we are his house, if we indeed hold firm to our confidence and the hope in which we glory. See to it, brothers and sisters, that none of you have sinned, unbelieving hearts that turn away from the living God, but encourage one another daily as long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by sin's deceitfulness. We have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original conviction firmly to the very end." Amen. Psalm 90:12 says, "Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom." Let us understand what we're living for, what the point of today is. Let us not worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow has enough worries of its own. We are here now for a purpose. We should find out what that is. We should discern what that is according to God's will and his kingdom to be established. Let us put on the full armor of God and continue to fight the battle before us, for there is indeed a battle going on of good versus evil. I believe God has equipped us in this time to have minds of knowledge, love, to have our hearts go out to those who need it, to find what is true and to speak it without fear. The final lesson Edmund received from the priest in the cell next to him was, "Do not commit the crime for which you now serve the sentence." And we are all serving a sentence on this sin-filled earth for crimes that we would have committed. If we were in Adam and Eve's position, we'd have done the same thing because we wouldn't have known any better, just like they didn't know any better. We are being punished for our sin, but we don't have to be inflicted and held down by that in this earth. We can stand on the rock that is Christ, stand on the Word of God, stand on the knowledge and confidence that we have in that. Do not commit the crime for which you now serve the sentence. So don't live your life in sin-filled, who cares, Christ will forgive it again anyways. That's not the point. Don't commit the crime that you're serving the sentence for. This is a hard life to live, but we don't have to continue on in our sin-filled nature. We don't have to indulge sin or even allow its presence. The devil will always drop his kids off on your porch, but you don't have to invite them in, feed them, clothe them, and make them comfortable. Temptation's like looking at evil through a keyhole. Sin is opening that door and allowing evil to dine with you. We don't have to allow or accept its presence. Get behind me, Satan. You are not of the things of my Father. You are of the things of this world. So stay strong in your faith today. Continue to encourage one another as you all encourage me. When you feel so at odds in this world, remember the line from the Switchfoot song, "This is home." We were created for a place we've never known. We were created for the garden. We were created for perfection. We just don't know it. We've never known it. That's why we're at odds here, because we weren't created for this place and this time. But God's allowed us to endure, and he gave us his Son as a Savior. Amen. That's all I got for you.
Have the musicians come on up. Faith of our fathers. You know, the spiritual fathers that came before us, they knew what their purpose was. And so this song shares that. It really speaks to it. I was thinking as you were talking, you know, the church is not supposed to be a cruise ship where we all get to be comfortable and get fed and all this great stuff. It's supposed to be a warship. You know, we're supposed to be on a mission. And like the Blues Brothers said, we're on a mission from God, right?
Amen.
So that makes it, yes. That makes it good. So we're going to have a time of prayer in a moment. And if you, as we sing, if you have not already written down your prayer requests on your cards, go ahead and write one up, and Larry will collect it as we sing, and then we'll have our time of prayer.
Faith of our fathers living still in spite of dungeons high and so. Truly free, faith.
As we go to prayer, you're welcome to stand if you like, sit if you need to, or if you'd rather sit, you're welcome to come up and kneel at the altar. And I think the first thing we need to do is we need to respond to Nathaniel's message. We need to make sure that our hearts are right with God, that we have not taken in this slow fade, you know. There is a keyhole in the door. The keyhole is the temptation. You look through the keyhole, is that how you put it? And then, but we don't need to open the door, do we? And you know what? Just knowing that the keyhole is there is enough. You don't have to look through it. I always used to say, if you know there's a monster in the closet, don't open the door. So, let's pray. Lord, we come to you grateful for the word of God that has been preached today. We thank you that you have spoken to our hearts and to our spirits, Lord. Lord, may your Holy Spirit convict us right now. See if there be any wicked ways in us, in me, in my heart, Lord. Cleanse us and make us whole. Help us to be in the white purity that you have called us to be. Make our sins white as snow. We pray, Lord, that as we confess to you that many times we've looked through that keyhole, and other times, Lord, we have opened the door, and still other times we've walked in and partaken and joined in the party. But Lord, we don't want to do that anymore. We repent of that. We recognize that you are God and we are not. We repent of those things that need repentance. In other words, we ask for your forgiveness, and we also turn from them. We're not going to do those things anymore with your help. And we receive by grace, by faith, we receive by faith the grace of your Holy Spirit into our hearts and lives. Lord, pour your love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Help us to live for you and for you alone. Help us to have the same faith of our fathers who were willing to martyr themselves, to give themselves to the cause of spreading the good news of Christ. People willing to die so that others might live. And Lord, as we turn now to some of these prayer requests, we pray for your special touch upon people, Lord. We lift up Betty Coates at home still, Lord. We pray that you would be with her, that she's having a bad day today. And we pray, Lord, that you will help her to breathe and help her to have energy. We pray for this vitamin B deficiency she has, Lord. That's a big problem, but you're bigger than what's the matter. You're the biggest God. You are so big, Lord. Just touch her body and heal her right now. Do something, Lord, that would make the doctors go, wow, that's a miracle. You turned around like that. Do something that only you will get the glory and credit for. Lord, Darlene and Steve want to lift up John Moore to you, their friend in Florida. He fell and has been unconscious in the ICU. He's starting to respond, though. So, Lord, we pray for John right now that you would help him to come back to his right mind, help him to get out of whatever, anesthesia, whatever may be there, Lord. But help him to come back to his right mind. Now, we pray that you would be there with him and for all who are there loving and caring for him. Just answer their prayers, Lord, pray. And Jennifer's dad, we want to lift up John Forrest to you. He's got back surgery July 14th coming up. So, Lord, please be with John. And as he heads off to the hospital, may he know that you are with him. Help him, Lord, to take whatever this back pain is and this back concern and have it do what's happened for many of us when we've had these kinds of things. It draws us to you, Lord. So I pray that you would use this, even the pain, to draw him to you so that he would know your grace and mercy and that he would receive healing for his soul even before he gets healing for his body. Ken Wilson, Greg's neighbor, these eye shots are painful. He doesn't appear to be helping his sight. Lord, I met Ken Wilson. He's a wonderful guy. The neighbor, Mr. Wilson. And we just ask, Lord, that these eye shots he's receiving, that they would do their work, that he would be able to see. We know some in our congregation who have maybe similar things and have to get a monthly eye shot, Lord. And Lord, we just pray for Ken, that you would touch him and heal him, help him to see you working around him, and help him, help his eyes to see all that you would have him to see. Well, we want to lift up Lacey Voigt to you, who is Gary and Peggy Spencer's granddaughter. Dear Lord, you know that she is pregnant and the baby has a kidney problem. Well, Lord, as she goes to a specialist this week, we pray that God will touch the baby and heal the kidney, even in the womb. Lord, that you would do that again. Do something. Lord, this baby is due in the fall, and we pray by then the baby would be just perfectly fine. Heal he or she even now. And lastly, Peggy asked for Ethan, that we pray for Ethan for help with depression. Lord, many of us suffer from depression, and it is something that comes and goes, and sometimes it just drags us down, Lord. And, but we lift up Ethan to you, Lord. He is loved, not only by his family, but he is loved by you. Lord, I pray that as a child of God, he would have a joy even when he's not happy. We can't be happy all the time, but we can be joyful. So I pray, Lord, that that your joy, the joy of the Lord, would be his strength. The Bible says the joy of the Lord is our strength. And we claim that for Ethan right now. Because depression makes us feel weak, Lord. We don't even want to get out of bed sometimes. We feel weak, but the joy of the Lord is our strength. So give him a joy that overrules and a peace that passes understanding. Oh, Lord, there are many here in our room and watching over the internet, or watching this video, Lord, that are grieving. We pray that you would comfort them. May your comfort, the Holy Spirit, Lord, Holy Spirit, we just ask that you would fill whatever gap is in someone's soul for the loss of a loved one or the concern for a loved one. That they would have a faith, as we sang, faith of our fathers. And Lord, we want to be true like them. We want to be true to thee till death. Help us to do that. You call us all to be overcomers, and you will overcome by your help and your grace and mercy. Lord Jesus, this is all in your precious holy name we pray, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Have a seat. Offerings are coming in very well. Thank you for the first half of the year. 50% of the year is done, and we're a little over 50% in meeting our budget. So we are right on track. So that is cool. And you know what? Because of the over and above and extra donations you've given, we were able to buy propane at the current low price. And so we've got a pre-buy of propane. We're good for the whole next season. So that isn't that awesome. So if you give toward propane, thank you. Keep giving, because we'll need some more. I don't know where it goes. It goes somewhere. Yes. Okay. And they're another Larry and Betty, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're coming from California. And Peggy, is your family on the way back?
Not till Thursday.
So they're still here.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have some heading out and some coming in. Boy. Nathaniel, or Matthew, what's that say? Albie?
Foster.
Yes, okay. And you want us to pray for Albie? And then some veterans of struggle. So, Lord, we want to pause in this moment and pray to you again. Lifting up Larry and Betty from California, Lord, they're on their way here. Would you watch over them? Send your angels to protect them. Surround their car with your angels that they might make it safe and sound. And keep them awake on the road and all of that. And Lord, for Peggy's family, will be heading back next Thursday to California. We ask that you give them traveling mercies as well and watch over them. Help their faith to grow with every mile that they travel. We lift up Albie Foster to you, Lord. You know what the need is there. We ask that your will would be done in his heart and life. And we also want to pray for our veterans, Lord. Our veterans, so many, even current soldiers in are committing suicide, Lord. And they say it's, 22 a day are dying, Lord. There is some spirit of depression among our military. And we don't exactly know what's all going on. I think it's more simple than just PTSD. I think it's a spiritual battle for the lives of these young men and women. And we cry out to you for them, and we pray that you would break through the depression that some of them feel, that are ready to just give up, that life would be better if life was over. It may be how they feel, but that is not true. Help them to see the truth of you, and may the joy of the Lord be their strength. You know, not the weapons they carry, not the flag they serve, not the country or the commander-in-chief or whoever that, you know, their officers are, Lord, that the joy of the Lord would be their strength. And then as they feel that strength, they can walk with you. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. There's always time for more prayer. Today, the week-long Family Camp, East Michigan Conference Family Camp. We've got a little information on it here. If you're on Facebook, there's a flyer. Just go to the Covenant Hills Facebook page. There's a lot of detail on there about what's happening. But you're welcome to come out. And even for the, you don't have to necessarily camp. Jesse and I are out there. We'll be on site 401. So if you want to come and visit us at our campsite, just remember 401. 401. Right? And the Dodds, they're going to come out. Not sure how much you'll be out there, but we hope you can stay for the whole week. 480. You're on 480 back up with us. And you moved up in Oak Ridge on the way back there with the rest of us crazy people. Yeah. Bring your bug spray. That's all I got to say. Yes, you do. We know. We kind of know. So there's a little picture there. You can kind of see it of the tabernacle. It's just a big, huge, all-purpose room, and it's air-conditioned and wonderful place. So come out for a 7 o'clock service each night, and you can see the speakers there listed. So any other family matters to share before we break for the day, okay? I will be out there, but I'll be coming back and forth, and it's only 20 minutes away, so you have my phone number. If you need anything, give me a call. I'll have my motorcycle along with the car so we can, you know, I won't leave her stranded too much. So, the garage sale, the yard sale is the last week, the third and fourth, the last two weekends of July. So it's the first day official will be July 21st. Okay, thank you, Charlene. And you're welcome to bring stuff already. People are already bringing things. You don't have to price them. We're probably going to do a donation thing. But bring them in through the front doors, up front there, downstairs, into the blue classroom, and just put them in there if you have donations to sell. If you would like to set up your own table and sell things from your home and make a donation from that, you're welcome to do that as well. So you could take advantage. The more we have out here in the parking lot, the more it'll attract attention and people will stop. So if you're thinking of having a garage sale at home, think instead about having it here. And it's going to be a Friday, Saturday, and then the following week, Friday, Saturday again, because Elizabeth wanted all 4 weeks, and we said maybe two's enough. She's pumped. She loves to sell stuff, apparently. So she'll probably shoot me when she sees or hears I said that. She's really gung-ho for it, and so that's exciting. And I really appreciate all she does for the church as my assistant and as our missionary and our camp promoter and all of that. She does a lot of great work. Well, let's stand together and praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. All right, go in God's grace and peace and love. And grow closer to God. Don't fade away. Amen? Amen.